Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. How do objects in our universe form? In the unimaginably vast cosmos, at all scales. From comets and asteroids in our solar system, to the vastest superclusters of galaxies stretching for hundreds of millions of light years, astronomers and astrophysicists imagine gravitational processes, and only gravitational processes governing these objects' formation. But the objects we see tell a different story and demand new theoretical pathways. In our own solar system, one of the most puzzling forms is the double-lobed shape of most comet nuclei imaged to date, a weirdly similar form also seen in nebulae, and even in the peanut-shaped cross-section of the galactic bulge of our own Milky Way. In this episode, physicist Wal Thornhill will explain why the pairing of celestial objects is a predictable effect of a universe governed not by gravity, but by electromagnetism.
It is almost 50 years since Hans Alfvén predicted the inevitable death of gravitational Big Bang cosmology. Why is it taking so long? The reason seems to be that cosmology has become a dogmatic belief system, as firmly entrenched as any religion, within a global fraternity who have been taught that computer modeling based on those beliefs will provide the answers, someday, at whatever cost. But computer models tend to have a life of their own. New parameters, forces, particles, and imaginary celestial objects can be introduced and endlessly adjusted to match almost any observation. Gone are the classically trained scientists of the 19th century who aimed for simplicity and matched theory against physical experiment. Today, theorists waste most of the computing power on Earth generating virtual reality objects and universes. They sit in front of computer screens reflecting back to them what they know about what they know about what they know. Meanwhile, the key is to be found in what scientists don't know they don't know, which is a consequence of dogmatic training that there is no alternative to gravity as the governing force in the universe. Yet no cosmologist will admit that the force of gravity remains unexplained in the 21st century. Einstein had the crazy idea there is no force, just our warped perception. This requires, according to the media celebrity Brian Cox, that you ignore the surroundings and define a falling object as being stationary. It works fine until the ground, for no apparent reason, smacks into the stationary object. The product of this nonsense is a fictional universe containing dark matter, dark energy, and black holes. Physics be damned. Clearly, theoretical Big Bang cosmology is fake science when there's another peer-reviewed and experimentally tested cosmology available, based on real electrical plasma behavior. And remember, practically the entire visible universe is in the plasma state. So plasma cosmology is where real physics answers are to be found. Alfvén, who was both a practical electrical engineer and physicist in the classical tradition, told very publicly in his acceptance speech for the 1970 Nobel Prize in Physics what theorists don't know about plasma. But it seems mathematical theorists don't like an alarm going off when they're busy playing computer games. Alfvén later wrote about the pressure by theorists on real astronomers. The result was the development of a cosmological establishment like that of the Ptolemaic orthodoxy, which did not tolerate objections or dissent. Alfvén accentuated the essential role of electric circuits in space plasma, and a circuit, by definition, carries electric current. Of course, there are no wires in space, but nature always contrives to do things in the simplest and most effective way. Charged particles encounter least resistance by following magnetic lines of force and producing what's known as field-aligned current filaments. Two parallel current filaments interact electromagnetically to draw closer and rotate about each other. The resulting twisted pair of plasma current filaments is named after an early pioneer of the electric universe, the Norwegian Christian Birkeland. So the key signatures of cosmic electricity are doubleness or pairing and rotation. On August 24th, phys.org published The Origin of Binary Stars. It makes the admission that the origin of binary stars has long been one of the central problems of astronomy. It's been found that protostars and young stars are more likely to be found in binary pairs strung at intervals along a filament inside a molecular cloud. About half of the binaries are in elongated core structures, and they conclude that the initial cores were also elongated structures. One of their most significant major conclusions is that each dusty core of material is likely to be the birthplace of two stars, not the single star usually modelled. This raises the real issue that astrophysicists don't understand how either the filaments or the stars are formed, something the plasma cosmologists have shown for half a century or more. Here's an image taken at sub-millimeter wavelengths of a star-forming core, showing that it contains two young stellar embryos. The caption says, "Astronomers have concluded from a systematic study of very young cores that most embryonic stars form in multiple systems, and later some of them separate." The problem is that astrophysicists are using a gravitational accretion model based on the concept of a centre of mass, which doesn't lend itself to preferentially producing pairs of stars. Meanwhile, the plasma cosmology model is electromagnetic, driven by a linear twisted pair of Birkeland current filaments. It's an inherently binary phenomenon. In the electric universe, stars and planets are formed along the Birkeland current filament by a powerful and long-range 1 over the square root of R electromagnetic scavenging force acting on the diffuse dust and gas in a molecular cloud. This compares to the puny short-range 1 over R squared gravitational force, which cannot form a filament anyway. On the basis that nature doesn't do anything the hard way, gravity just isn't the answer. To emphasize that science is only trivially self-correcting and has to undergo periodic revolutions or paradigm shifts, Hans Alfvén argued 40 years ago that stars are born in interstellar clouds by magnetic pinching along plasma current filaments. Infrared space telescopes like the Herschel Space Observatory spectacularly confirmed this 30 years later, but Alfvén remains ignored to this day. Old beliefs die hard. Plasma physicist Anthony Perrat was a student of Alfvén. Perrat's plasma cosmology textbook, Physics of the Plasma Universe, has on page 119 a section on doubleness in current conducting plasmas. He writes, "The 1 over R dependency of the Biot-Savart force law between current conducting filaments leads to a curious phenomenon, a pairing of filaments. This pairing leads directly to a two-ness or doubleness when many filaments are present in plasmas, in which the magnetic field plays a major role. The supercomputer simulation shown here is based on the electromagnetic interaction of a large number of charged particles moving in a magnetic field and demonstrates the evolving sequence between three filaments. It shows the two closest filaments interact strongly to form a spiral, while the third remains quiescent. So what do we find in the paper referred to by the phys.org report? The higher order star multiples generally contain a mix of components at wide and tight separations, and all systems have at least one component far from the center of the elongated core. This matches Perrat's simulation of multiple Birkeland current filaments. On the galactic scale, the elongated core is the central bar of a spiral formation. Here we see an X-ray image of the active galaxy Cygnus A, a relatively nearby galaxy containing a powerful quasar. It's the second strongest radio source in the sky. You can see three X-ray hotspots along an elongated core. X-rays pick out where matter and current density is highest. The two hotspots at the end of the elongated core, or bar, of the galaxy are the footprints of twin galactic Birkeland currents. In a repeated pattern at the galactic scale, it has been found that, like stars, galaxies are also strung like Catherine wheel fireworks along cosmic wires. But instead of producing twin stars, they generate spiral arms full of stars from the ends and along the rotating bar. The central hotspot in the bar is due to the electromagnetic plasmoid jet engine at the heart of all active galaxies. It is the quasar factory required by Halton Arp's research. Since the twin Birkeland currents are great plasma attractors, they will form a thick toroid of matter as they rotate about the galactic centre. Seen edge-on, it gives a peanut profile to the galactic bulge. So what do scientists find? A Hubble news release in 1994 titled "Hubble Uncovers a Hidden Quasar in a Nearby Galaxy, Cygnus A," says, "Though Cygnus A is categorized as an elliptical galaxy, it has an unusual peanut shape due to a dark band of dust encircling the enigmatic nucleus." Needless to say, the hidden quasar in Cygnus A is a mystery. "I was stunned when we realized we had a quasar. It was a total surprise," said Dr. Anne Kinney of the Space Telescope Science Institute, Baltimore, Maryland. The report explains that most quasars existed billions of years ago in the early universe, and so it's unusual to find one in our own epoch. Though this provides an unexpected opportunity for close-up study of the mysterious engine behind a quasar, these results add further mystery as to the true nature of the powerhouse. Finally, the report adds, "Previous ground-based radio observations show that there is an elongated optical object in the Cygnus A's core. This is inconsistent with black hole models that predict a compact point source of radiation." Forget imaginary gravitational black holes. Overpowering electromagnetic forces dominate in galaxies. All of these observations are consistent with plasma cosmology and Halton Arp's observations of quasar birth from active galactic nuclei. It supports his evidence against redshift being a measure of great age and distance of quasars. Galactic redshift is a measure of youthfulness of a quasar. In other words, the universe isn't expanding. There was no Big Bang. The universe is of unknown origin, age, and extent. There is no need for cosmology to compete with creation myths. I wrote in 2006, "On this website I have made many successful yet unusual predictions based on the electric universe cosmology. For example, what would be seen when close-ups were taken of Io's volcanoes? The initial flash and unexpected outburst from deep impact? What would be found beneath the clouds of Titan? And the link between spiral forms at the poles of Venus and the hot spot at Saturn's south pole. If the test of a good theory is successful predictions, the electric universe is unparalleled. Even better if it can simply explain details in the new images of Saturn's south pole." Earlier in February 2005, I had written about Venus. "We should expect to see evidence of the twisted pair configuration at the poles of Venus, if the input current is sufficiently strong and this model is correct. The Venusian polar dipole shows the precise configuration and motion of Birkeland current pairs in plasma discharge experiments. That includes a surrounding spiral vortex. Professor Fred Taylor of the University of Oxford Atmospheric, Oceanic and Planetary Physics Department wrote about the Venusian polar vortex. The absence of viable theories which can be tested, or in this case any theory at all, leaves us uncomfortably in doubt as to our basic ability to understand even gross features of planetary atmospheric circulations. Yet the same phenomenon discovered on Saturn years later again puzzled scientists. My web article titled "The Spiral Galaxy at Saturn's Pole" quotes a NASA report that describes a hurricane-like storm at Saturn's south pole with a well-developed eye ringed by towering clouds. The storm is approximately 8,000 kilometers or 5,000 miles across, or two-thirds the diameter of the Earth. It looks like a hurricane, but it doesn't behave like a hurricane," said Dr. Andrew Ingersoll, a member of Cassini's imaging team at the California Institute of Technology in Pasadena. It is locked to the pole and doesn't drift around. A movie taken by Cassini's camera over a three-hour period saw the shadow cast by a ring of towering clouds surrounding the pole and two spiral arms of clouds extending from the central ring. These ring clouds, 30 to 75 kilometres, that is 20 to 45 miles, above those in the centre of the storm, are 2 to 5 times taller than the clouds of thunderstorms and hurricanes on Earth. Though it is unlikely moist convection is driving Saturn's storm, the dark eye at the pole, the eye wall clouds and the spiral arms together indicate a hurricane-like system. The clear skies over the eye appear to extend down to a level about twice as deep as the usual cloud level observed on Saturn, said Dr. Kevin Baines of Cassini's Visual and Infrared Mapping Spectrometer team. This gives us the deepest view yet into Saturn over a wide range of wavelengths and reveals a mysterious set of dark clouds at the bottom of the eye. Those dark clouds are the footprints of twin Birkeland current filaments, seen here reflecting the maxima in a computer simulation of the magnetic energy distribution between two Birkeland current filaments in the inset. Notice particularly the energy hotspot's distribution is identical to that seen in Cygnus A. It indicates that powerful storms on Earth like a hurricane, with eye wall clouds and spiral arms, are driven electrically and not simply by solar heat in rising moisture. This, in turn, suggests that climate scientists are missing the most powerful influence on extreme weather events. It seems to be clinched by the Mount Everest-high dust devils on Mars that generate a planet-wide dust storm for months. There's not much solar heating or air mass on Mars sufficient to drive this remarkable phenomenon. In fact, it is the Martian dust devils that form the dusty atmosphere and warms it by trapping sunlight. A change in external electrical energy causes a change in climate, so we should look to our electric sun's activity for answers to climate change on Earth. Our recent space news on the double-lobed form of many asteroids and comets receives a simple explanation based on their formation in an electrical exchange between two planetary bodies. Each filament will tend to concentrate matter excavated from the more negative body into two lobes joined by a bar or neck. It explains the mixture of planet surface form minerals and high temperature minerals found in comet dust. Comets do not hold the secrets to the formation of the Earth, but to the violent electrical encounters between bodies sometimes captured by the sun. The twin filament nature of electric currents in plasma causes us to see double effects at the galactic scale, at the stellar scale, at the planetary scale, the cometary scale, and right on down to the laboratory scale. Such vast scalability of plasma phenomena is an overwhelming advantage of plasma cosmology over gravitational Big Bang cosmology. It has been shown to be highly explanatory and predictive. These are the hallmarks of a successful model. Plasma cosmology doesn't require fudging with dark matter, black holes, and dark energy. It suggests the hugely expensive high-energy particle physics and gravitational wave experiments are a waste of money when gravitational theory has no physical basis. The mathematician John Wheeler described gravity in metaphysical terms. Matter tells space-time how to curve, and space-time tells matter how to move. The words space-time and tells are physically undefined. It isn't physics. Alfvén was right. Astrophysics is in crisis, as shown by the perpetual state of surprise at new discoveries. Charles McKay was right when he wrote Extraordinary Popular Delusions and the Madness of Crowds in 1841. Men, it has been well said, think in herds. It will be seen that they go mad in herds, while they only recover their senses slowly and one by one.